Great. Well, good to see you all. My name is Aiden Saunders from Squiffle Consulting, and this is the introduction to Civi. So, I think this was built as kind of for those who, in a sense, know nothing about Civi, although you know enough to have got to CiviCRM. So, we'll be interested to know quite what your sort of background is, and so on, and you know, kind of quite why you're here. But before we do that, so what we're going to talk about today, a little bit in terms of who's who and kind of your interests in things. What is Civi? That's kind of the point. Getting started, how you might actually get going with Civi in various different ways. We'll then have a look at a Civi installation and some of the things that we can do on that, and go from there. Be particularly space at the end for questions, but ask questions as we go along. Be far more interesting for everybody if you've got questions rather than just listening to me. Okay, so let's have a quick go around in terms of quite who's who. Who you are, what organisation you're with, what's your interest in Civi? So kind of how come you're here? What are you, and what are you looking to get out of CiviCRM overall? We're trying to encourage people to come this way, so a bit more of a compact group, if you don't mind. And what are looking to get out of CiviCRM over these couple of days. So, have we got a brave volunteer to go first? Excellent, thank you.
I'm Sam, I'm from Healthwatch Cornwall. Interest in CiviCRM is that our national coordinating organisation wants all the local organisations to use Civi. They've adapted it for the local organisations, and I'm finding out what Civi can do and how best to present the business case for it to our members. I hope to achieve that information by participating today.
Okay, great. Thank you.
My name's Nick. I work as the IT manager for an organisation called AFS, which is a global educational organisation. And we're currently looking to utilise more CRM functionality inside of some of our core systems. Given the federated structure of the organisation globally, we don't qualify for a lot of the big CRM platform, commercial CRM platforms, non-profit licensing. And Civi looks like it could be a useful tool, so I'm just here to learn a little bit more over the next few days.
Okay, so in that sort of kind of investigation phase of,
exactly, yeah.
What is Civi, would it be a good fit for what we're looking at? Yeah. Okay, great.
I'm Gavin, I run a conservation NGO called International Animal Rescue. We've been looking at trying to get a web integrated CRM for many years and had various poor attempts at it. So I've been looking at Civi for a while and seeing it evolve. Mm-hmm. I'm sort of wondering whether now's the time to make the leap.
Okay, very good.
My name is Jenny. I work at Basca, which is a music membership organisation. And my interest and what I'm hoping to achieve from coming to CiviCRM is just learning a bit more about the membership side of it and contributions and all these different things that I've got to know before I start my job on Monday.
Okay, right. So Basca's already using Civi and yeah. You're moving into there and need to know about Civi. Okay, great.
My name's Adrian. The organisation is Krieger. I'm a developer and an implementer. I want to get two things out of CiviCRM. Firstly, here to sort of reconnect from my earlier self when I knew nothing about Civi, and I think that, to get that perspective again. And secondly, Civi's a big beast, and whilst I'm familiar with parts of it, there's parts of it that I absolutely don't know, and I'd like to get some information on.
Okay, great.
Hey, my name's Nadia. I work for a Belgian NGO called Apopo, which you might know, Hero Rats. We train giant rats to sniff out landmines and detect TB. The reason why I'm here is that we currently use CiviCRM. We also use it as our fundraising database. And the guy that had all the knowledge and was training me has left the organisation, and there's nobody else that has any knowledge.
Okay.
So I'm here to go,
No. So you're sort of fast track from not a lot to expert.
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Hi, I'm Joanna, and I work for a lady who started a very small charity, an elderly lady who's retired. And I think she started using Civi in January and asked me if I'd volunteer to sort of help out with it, which I have. I've used other CRMs before, and so far I'm kind of making things up as I go along. I think maybe I need to go back to the beginning, and I'm doing okay, but I am struggling with how user-friendly it is.
Mm-hmm.
So I've actually got a whole list of questions, but this today might not be the time or the place. But she offered for me to come along just to meet other people, maybe see if I can get some contacts.
Yep. Okay, we'll see how we go in terms of this and what questions seem to fit with this, but otherwise, let's talk afterwards if you like. Certainly. Answer all sorts of questions.
Hello, I'm Liz. I work for a charity called the Association for Citizenship Teaching. We're a teachers' membership organisation. We already use CiviCRM integrated with our Drupal website and Xero finance system. But my knowledge is very limited, and we're also a very small charity, and at the moment one person holds the knowledge. So although I'm not a sort of day-to-day user, I want to know more and just learn more about it from a very small knowledge base, really.
Okay. So use it a bit, but want to hear more. Yep.
I'm James. I'm the communications director for an organisation called Redcliffe College. We are a small college that offers postgraduate continuing professional development for the Christian faith, charity development and cross-cultural sector. We are too small to use a big university CRM or management system. We are too old for a primary school one or a further education one. At the moment, the best we've got is about 14 little spreadsheets all on everybody's computer.
Yep.
So I'm here to try and see whether there's an option that doesn't cost 50 grand and that can meet all our needs and customizable.
Yeah, yeah. I think it's a very common starting point of you've got how many spreadsheets and then a bit kind of multiplying out of hand, and it's like, how do we bring those together and do something? Yeah.
Hi, I'm Russ. I'm from Circle Interactive, who are one of the main CiviCRM developers and hosts, but I'm from the business management side of the business rather than the technical side, so I'm kind of, my knowledge is kind of patchy. I've been working there for about a year, so I'm here to sort of fill in the gaps and kind of starting what up with, and making sure I've got my whole picture filled.
Okay, great.
Hi, I'm John. I'm the head of marketing communications at Time Stop Relationships, which is a charity that provides training and also actually clinical services to people with relationship challenges. I came in, caught for the horse. We have Civi, wasn't necessarily my choice. It's being implemented at the moment, but I think it's always good to step back, bring up behind the line, even when you're in it, just to understand what the basic concepts of it are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very good.
I'm Terry Finnegan. I work for Oasis Trust. I just started working for Oasis 3 months ago. I've been using Civi for about 2 years.
Okay, very good. So you've just started working for them, so
yeah.
They're using Civi, you're coming out, it's a bit like somebody saying across here with Basco, isn't it?
Yeah.
Coming into an organisation that's already using Civi and you're looking to get up to speed with it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
My name's Tom. I work for the Association for Learning Technology. We're a membership organisation and we use Civi. We're a very small organisation and we're often looking to use Civi to try and streamline our operations. So I guess I'm looking to gain, I suppose, a more intelligent understanding as formulaic understanding.
Okay, great.
Good morning. I'm Danny Cohen, Head of Business Development at NFP Services, who are a gold sponsor today. I've been with the organisation for 2 weeks, and so a bit of chutzpah that I'm here to see if anyone wants to buy it, but also to learn what I'm selling.
Good. And one of the things you'll rapidly learn is that it's open source, so nobody buys it. Hopefully that's kind of helpful to hear where other people are coming from too. So what is Civi? Well, it's a CRM. So C gets interpreted various different ways. Some people talk about contacts, or constituents, clients, or even customers. But whichever one of those you want to use, It's about those people and the way that you as organization can kind of manage the relationships that you have with them. I tend to go for contact management, contact being very much kind of a civvy word and term, and you'll hear that in lots of different places. And contacts really are anyone that you have contact with. So they might be donors, they might be newsletter recipients, they might be your trustees, they might be other organizations you work with, and so on. So pretty much anyone and everything that you have some sort of contact with. And it's particularly designed for nonprofits, for charities. That's its core, that's where it came from, that's its focus. So it's not a it's not a free version of a commercially focused CRM. It's specifically for, say, charities and nonprofits. It is used by others. Some small businesses use it because it's much the same sort of thing. There are people that you need to connect with as any sort of business. But that's its focus. It's web-based, so you can access it from anywhere that has appropriate internet access. Means it's accessed through a browser, so there's no client software to install on users' desktops or laptops, that sort of thing. And it's open source. So there are no licensing costs involved. Nobody buys CiviCRM. CiviCRM itself is open source, is free. We sometimes say that it's free to use, it's not free to develop. You know, it takes a lot of time and effort going into it from various different angles to develop it and keep it up to date. A lot of that is done really as a result of particular organizations wanting to do something a little bit different with Civi. So whether it's through a change to a piece of the core, or as Tim was talking about earlier, through extensions and writing a separate piece for that. And so the normal sort of process then is that organization is going to pay someone to develop that particular extra piece, and then that gets contributed back to the overall setup and everybody benefits. And so it's very much a sort of collective in that sense, of lots of people contributing in and lots of people benefiting. So it's software, but it's also a community. Again, some of the things that Tim and Eileen were talking about just in the previous session is very much that. So I'd say that community exists and encompasses a variety of different people. We tend to talk about of users, so organizations and individuals who are actually using Civi on a day-to-day or regular kind of basis for supporting whatever they do. There's the core team. So core team, I think, it was nine, I think it's about that. People, those are the only people who are paid by CiviCRM itself, the organization. that consists of developers like Tim. Josh isn't here this time around, but he looks after a lot of the community side of things and so on. And so they're, if you like, at the sort of at the heart of what's going on in terms of the direction of Civi and what's happening next. Then there are a range of so-called Civi partner organizations. So Squiffle, my setup is a Civi partner, as is Circle and NFP at the back there. And in the UK, I think we now have nine different partner organizations. Many people choose to work with a partner or another implementer in terms of they're getting their Civi system up and going. It is big and complex, there's a lot to it, and it's sometimes a bit likened to, you have your box of Lego, and in theory you can make whatever you like, but it sometimes helps to have a bit of knowledge in terms of how you're going to put it together. So there are various places that community gets, or you get in contact with that community. So, and again, they talked about Stack Exchange as the question place. If you see reference to forums, that was what we had before Stack Exchange. And that's from which we can go and ask a question. Love those stats. 78% of the time you might get an answer. Whether it's a useful answer, it doesn't matter, but generally it's pretty good. And then there's the chat, which is the kind of interactive side of things. There's obviously CiviCon. This is an annual event. I think for the last 3 years has been, you know, in this place at about this time. There are local meetups. So who is in the kind of London area? Yeah, okay, great. So we have a meetup. It's normally the last Wednesday of the month, I think, in London, open to anybody interested in Civi. It's normally kind of a couple of hours. And yeah, we talk about Civi stuff, usually a couple of different presentations on things, and then mostly head down to the pub afterwards to continue the chat. So those are good. If you want to know more about those, can happily tell you that. Stats. It may or may not work, I'll leave it, but because you've seen the stats page that they were talking about. But one of the graphs on there was kind of a bar chart showing the different sort of size of Civi systems that are out there. And on the kind of right at the left-hand side was, I think, systems up to about 250 contacts. So small, and there were thousands of those. But then we go right up to a whole bunch of, I think it's kind of over 100 setups that are over 250,000 contacts. So it's used by a very wide range of people and setups and sizes. it's big and it's flexible. There's a lot you can do with it. So I'd say really Civi is both the software, but it's also the community around it. Any questions on any of those pieces before we move on? No? Okay, good. So getting started, the main kind of center, I suppose, is that the main Civi website, civicrm.org. From there, you can find links to all sorts of other stuff, including these are the pages down here. So, and there's the whole getting started section, which in turn lists all sorts of other things you might kind of have a look at on that website. There are case studies of different things. We have what's called an ambassadors program, where you can, you know, contact someone who's using Civi to get kind of their take on it and experience and so on. There's a lot of documentation. So the Civi docs are, yeah, pretty good. And that's on from the documentation link, that's organized more as a book, more as a manual you can have a look at. You'll also see links in various places to the wiki. The wiki is, if I say, less curated, in the sense of there's stuff there that is quite old, the stuff that's very current. Certainly in terms of a sort of a getting started side of things, I'd suggest probably the manual, the main documentation link is a better place to go than the wiki itself. so there's all sorts of stuff you can read and have a look at and try and get to grips with kind of what the thing is and what it's about. From there, you may want to talk to someone. Again, there's a link there to the partners listing, and you can see all the, you know, various different partners on there. I mentioned the ambassadors thing. Likewise, if you want to talk to someone, you can try it. On the website, there are also links to a couple of demo systems. Have a look at it, poke around on there, try different things. It is public, so obviously, you know, whatever you put in there could be seen by anybody. You may find that the language is in something strange because somebody's been experimenting to see quite what the latest, I don't know, Danish version looks like. If you know where you're going, you can get through the options to reset it back to English, otherwise wait a bit and somebody else will have set it back to English. Alternatively, it's open source. You can download it, you can stick it on a system and try it. But beware, it's not just a matter of kind of download it and run the executable. It's not like that. It does take quite a bit in terms of getting it installed and set up and so on. So if you're kind of comfortable with kind of web server configuration and creating databases and that sort of thing, then that's a possible route of download it and try it yourself. If those sorts of words and phrases leave you cold, then don't try downloading it. That's not a good option. Go to the demo sites and try those instead. That'll be a more productive way forward for you. Okay, so I think that's, yeah. So there's a lot else under the Getting Started link on the Civi site. And it's all trying to pull together all sorts of different bits and pieces to give you, a way into getting to grips with Civi. So, we'll have a look at a demo so you can actually see the thing and see what it's like. Before we get to that, any questions at this point? Oh, you're a very quiet lot. Okay, now let's see whether this works. Yeah, okay. Okay, so this is running a, is that all right from the back? You can see that reasonably? Big enough? Yeah, good, okay. So this is running a demo system. When you install Civi, you get the option of installing some, you know, dummy demo data. And that's what this is here. So all this is fictitious stuff, but it gives you a something to have a look at and see the sorts of things that Civi does. This first screen we're looking at here, this is the dashboard. So once you've logged into Civi, this is what you see. And this is the piece that you as an individual, an individual user of the system, can configure to be however you like. And a little link up here to configure your dashboard. You see the various different options around here. And if we were to drag in, you know, so say we're not interested in a membership summary, but we'd rather have our donors across here. We can do that sort of thing. We'll pull in some news down this side. And it'll go away and refresh those and come back with that. So you get to configure this. This is an individually based thing. The choices that you have under this configure section, we'll look a little later, but these pieces are things that we can create and customize for your site. You can do them. Those in most cases are reports. So report somewhere at the top. So that's the dashboard, which is quite useful. You can have then a quick view of the stuff that's important to you versus what's important to somebody else. But let's look through the overall structure of what's here. And I should say this Civi system is configured with all the components enabled, all the standard components, and there's one or two extra pieces that we'll point out as we go along. So at the top here, we've got these various tabs, search, contacts, contributions. So searching, how do you find stuff? It's great having everything in a big database, but you've got to be able to find what you need. And there's a lot of options for that. Contacts, as I said, contacts, anybody you have contact with. So individuals, organizations. Contributions, that's the money section. So whether it's a donation, whether it's a payment for an event, whether it's, you know, membership fees, anything like that is a contribution in Civi terms. Events, we can, if you run events of any sort that people, you know, book to come on, they might be paid things, they might be free ones, and so on. Those are events. Mailings, if you want to send out, you know, your monthly newsletter to however many thousand people, mailings are the place to go. Memberships, if you have, an annual membership scheme, that's what that's all about, managing that, keeping that current and tracking status of people as time goes on. Campaigns sort of function really as a for like a way of bringing together a variety of different things. So if you had, say, maybe it's a big Christmas project that you're heading towards, and so you might have some events relating to that, you might have some mailings, you might have various different activities that you want to kind of be able to look at in some way altogether related to that. That's a campaign. Cases are, if like the workflow component of Civi. So an organization I was talking last week, they have a pretty defined process for bringing on a new volunteer. So in order for someone to be, as they were accepted as a volunteer, they have to do various checks, they have to undergo a certain amount of training, a certain amount of paperwork that needs to be done, and so on. And you can kind of put all those activities listed together and manage those as a case, so that you can see where somebody is in that sort of volunteer onboarding process. Grants are if you're an organization that makes grants out to other people. So this is not about you receiving in grants, this is about grants you make out. And there's a section for handling that. Reports on kind of all of the above, all the different pieces of Civi, whether it's in terms of people or memberships or activities or all those sorts of things. Administer, that's the main section for kind of the setting up of Civi and configuring it to be as you want it to be. Support has links off to various different things, including the documentation and so on. And Civi Mobile, I'll come back to later, that's an extension that we've got installed on here. So it's not part of the core Civi, but it's something you can download and install. So that's kind of a very quick tour of the kind of the main pieces of Civi and what it's got there. In that top left-hand box is the contacts bit, which is a useful little box for searching. And I come up here and I start typing something, and you see as soon as I start typing it iteratively refines the list of matches. Those are not necessarily matching at the beginning of the name. So we've got, so Bachman is, but Global Field Initiative is actually matching on the BA of Global. So that's it's a quick and easy way of finding those contacts through there, and is useful. You don't have to just search by the name and email. There's a range of different things down there that you can search by. Some of those terms may not make much sense just yet, like contact ID and external ID. They will do eventually, but first name, last name, and so on. So that quick search is useful. Sometimes gets missed because it's kind of right up in that left-hand corner, but it's a good place to start. At the heart of Civi are contacts, and there are three types of contacts in Civi. There are individuals, households, and organizations. Individuals, fairly straightforward. Organizations, fairly straightforward. Organizations can, are in a sense, whatever you define them to be. So it's not that they need some sort of particular legal structure behind them. They might be, kind of chapters of an organization kind of thing, there's a lot of different things they could be, but it's some sort of entity. Households are useful in some situations, particularly if you're doing things that are kind of relating to families, where you're trying to keep track of the various different members of the family and sort of treat them in one go or not. You will find differing opinions within the civic community as to whether or not households are a good thing, or whether they're something that we've kind of got better ways of dealing with now and essentially grown beyond. I think the jury is still out in terms of quite what's, you know, what is the best way of handling some of those. I have some setups that use ourselves, some that don't. Yeah, please do.
Can I ask a small question on households? When you're coming to output data, when you're coming to output data like name, address, or email addresses, can you specify you want one per household?
You could print from the household record itself.
If you're preparing a list, like for a mail shot or something, can you say I want people who give me more than £50 or something, but only give me one per household? Kind of common thing to do on mail.
Yes, it is. There are various ways around it, but not as straightforwardly as you'd like it to be honest. No.
It's kind of like, if I could do that, yep, then I'd be interested in using the household. If
right.
If I can't do that, then it's kind of, it's the less useful.
Yeah. So it depends kind of is where you're going to go next, having identified that bunch of people. So if you're going to print address labels, then there are some options when you do that of merging the household contacts so that you get a single label coming out. If you're sending emails, it may not matter that much, I suppose, if you send to both parties. There are some ways you can achieve that sort of thing, but as I say, to be honest, it's not as straightforward as you might like it to be.
I've seen people making it households to make sure that when they're sending out pamphlets and booklets and things like that, they only send one per household.
Right. Yeah. You could. Okay. One option that you might want to look at, this is a kind of a, I'm not quite too sure how we would address your thing, but different possibilities would be, this is the advanced search, so if you were to look for the households themselves, and so within households, there are two defined relationship types, there's a member of a household, and there's head of household. But we haven't talked about relationships yet. We'll get to that in a minute. There are things called relationships between different types of contact. To get to your bit, broadly I'd start by doing a search for households and then looking at the related members of head of household, so you could then bring back, assuming you only had one head of household defined, you would then bring back that list of people that you could, that might be an option. Depends how your relationships are set up, but it's an option you might want to look at. Yeah.
Sorry, can I just ask, it might be quite basic, when I started using Civi, it had already been set up. I'm not sure whether some of the search, sort of under search titles, are appropriate. So, for example, if you hit search and new individual, find contacts, new individual. So for example, where you've got a new student, new parent, new staff, have you customised those? You've added them based on your...
Yes, those are... They're a standard feature of this demo data, yes, but in terms of a base Civi system, then you will just have new individual, new household, new organisation. So from there, you define or can define what are referred to as contact subtypes. So we're saying, so somebody, yes, is an individual, but they're a student, they're a parent, they're a staff member. And one of the reasons that you do that is if you then want to store particular information relating to that person as a student. So you might want something, for example, it's, you know, which year group they're in or class or options they've taken or that sort of thing, which isn't relevant to everyone. So you don't want to have that information, you know, attached to parents, for example. But
where you've added new student, new parent, new staff, can you search under all of those then as a group?
Yeah, so we'll come just to this. This is the basic search screen, and the contact, the advanced one has kind of all that and a load more. But here we can search for, for example, if we are interested in students, we could search there. I'm not sure quite what there actually is in the system. Okay, nothing. That's not helpful. Let me take this one. And I will very quickly make this one a student. So you see now in this little box here, it's saying it's a student. And if I do a search, for students, then we'll see that one contact returned. So yes, you can search that way to find them. So there's three basic contact types, and then we define subtypes. Somebody might be kind of sit in multiple camps, so they might be both a parent and a staff member. That's fine. They can have those extra additional roles. So if we look at, whoever this person is. So again, this is just the dummy data that comes. And what we have, yes, is Betty, and we've got along here a number of these tabs, which broadly corresponds to the tabs you're seeing at the top. So this is telling us that she's made two contributions. She doesn't have any pledges we didn't talk about in the first lot of things, but pledges are, you know, where somebody is committed to, you know, kind of an ongoing payment to you. There are memberships. She doesn't have any memberships. There's one event registration that she's got. There are activities. We haven't talked about them yet. We will. Cases, grants, relationships, groups, etc. So we've got these different tabs across the top with additional information, and then this is our summary screen. So as we're seeing here, we said this one is just an individual. We've got contact details. And you can see that's a stop sign, because under the privacy settings, we said don't email her. So we've got an email address, but for some reason, we're not gonna mail her. Maybe she's requested not to receive mails. And then, yes, we're saying we can have additional information beyond just the things that Civi defines for you. And those are, we call custom fields. And these are the bits that, if you like, very much make Civi your own and make it useful for your organization as opposed to just a generic setup. So all the kind of common stuff in terms of name, address, date of birth, date of death, all that sort of thing. That's all common things. On this one, we've defined some extra fields down here of things that are significant to this organization. Again, actually the first three of those are standard dummy data. And then there's some extra additions on my one down there. But this is custom data. We define what we want to record. And one of the big pieces in the planning of a system really is looking and saying, so what's all the stuff that you've got, huh? What do you want to record, but also what's the best way of recording it? Some of these pieces in Civi, there's multiple different ways that you might go about recording something, and to some extent it depends what you think you want to do with it, and how you might use that information as to quite what the best way of recording it is. To a large extent, certainly in terms of a kind of a play system, try it one way, see what works, try a different way. Very often if you've got data in one particular way, you can massage it around to get to a different form. But in terms of a kind of a successful ongoing system, then this is kind of a key part of figuring out how you're going to map the various bits of data and record the different things. Okay, so if we continue looking at this one contact, under the contributions.
Quick question on those fields.
Yeah,
if you were to depreciate one of those fields, right, and you thought, these days we don't need to know who their significant other is.
Yep.
We've moved on, the world has moved on, whatever. Can we hide that data but retain it so we don't take it out of the system altogether, but we can clean up
the data so you so we're only ever viewing what we need to view?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. That's good.
If you want to get into how, we can look at that, but basically, yeah, you can disable those fields. So the data is retained, but all right. We won't get too sidetracked onto these, but just to show you very briefly, we come to the custom fields. We were looking at constituent information down here. We have a set of these various different fields, and when we set them up, we define what type of field they are and all the rest of it. One of the options across here is this disable. So if I disable that, so that's most important issue that we're disabling. If we come back and look at our friend Betty again, then down the bottom here, there is no important issue.
But if we were to enable it again, we should start the same data.
Yes. So contributions, two things. She registered for an event and she made a donation. For current purposes, we'll kind of stick with saying, yes, you define all sorts of different stuff in terms of the kind of the financial type. So it's member dues versus donations versus whatever else you might be doing. You get down there, a payment method, credit card or check or whatever else. and obviously the dates on which those things were done. So it gives you that quick view into whatever, you know, financial interactions you've had with her. And yes, here was an event registration, so we've got the payment for that event. But if we come across to the events tab itself, we'll see there more detail about her participation in that and what she did and when she registered and whether she attended or not and all that sort of thing. Activities.
Sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
If you go back to contributions. Oh, okay. So if you became a member of, say, for example, charity, would it be in contribution and under membership? It would be a monetary contribution, so it would be in two categories.
Yes. So you'd have one that is the membership aspect of it, that they're a whatever standard member for a year.
And that she's been to the event, and it's also in the event tab.
Just the same way, yes. Yeah.
Is the median like that because there are only two? Or is that a bug? Doesn't matter, but...
Yes. I think it probably is, yeah, because it's the two. Yeah. Yes, we're showing the mean. Sorry. The average is 37.50.
Sorry, they're showing two donations, and the median is showing the mean value rather than.
There is no median. Put a third one in. Would it then show the median?
Let's try. Okay, so let's record a contribution. And I could do a membership, yeah, okay. Okay, so we'll come to memberships and we're going to add a membership.
Sorry.
No, it's all, you know, actually seeing it in action, which is, I suppose, what this is about. So we have these three different membership types currently defined in the system. We go and define what types we want and all that sort of thing, obviously. Here, blah, 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 blah. We're going to the amount. So it's filled based on me selecting up here that it's a student. It's then filled in the amount down here that it should be and so on. And we don't do anything more than hit save. So up in this box, we've got a student membership has been added, and it will run until October 15th. With the memberships, you can either have them so they run sort of kind of, as it were, from now for 12 months or the calendar 12 months and it will run till December kind of thing. I mean, there's obviously more options than that within membership, but you can either go sort of from this point onwards or for a particular period. So we have done that. So now we have this student membership. We can view that. And it tells us a bit more about it in terms of when it was. You'll see also we've got a related contribution of the 50 down here, telling us that we've done that. And we can expand that out on here. Da, 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 da. Okay. But and then you'll see contributions has crept up to 3. And if we go there, our median now looks better. Yes. yeah. And we've got those 3 in there. You know, the most recent one comes at the top. But if any of these little things you can sort by. So I'm trying to find one that makes some sense to sort by. So if we wanted to see them around the other way, we could click that. And we've now got the oldest one first, as opposed to the newest one last. If we click by maybe amount, we can sort them back into that sort of order and so on. So we've got choices in terms of what we see here.
What's the difference between completed contributions and completed? Is it that a membership isn't completed until the end of that year? Or? So it's 2 completed contributions and 3 completed.
I think completed on contributions just means the financial transaction contribution.
I think that's carrying on the current year to date. Completed contributions are 2. Uh-huh. So that one was 2010, these 2 are this year. Oh, okay. So I think that's picking up those 2 as opposed to the 3 being all of them that are completed. let's not run off with that one. Okay. If you have, you can set up what are called payment processes, so that you can actually take credit card donations and handle those through here. So this particular screen is where we could record a kind of donation over the phone, sort of thing. We wanted to do that. The same payment processes get used, for example, when we have an event that we're making available to be booked online and people pay. Through there.
How can you plug in different credit card sort of transaction?
Yeah, there are different. So, for example, there's things for PayPal, for Stripe, for whatever. So there are a number of different ones around.
But this supports a broad range of.
It supports a variety of different ones. Yes. And this one of the sort of areas where there's sort of ongoing work really in terms of how best do we do stuff in terms of finance and so on. And Eileen, who was in the previous session, is very much involved in kind of leading the charge on some of that stuff. But in terms of what exists at the moment, yes, you can. There's a variety of different payment processes.
Can you do direct debits as well?
You can. Not from the. It's not part of the core functionality, but there are additional extensions that you can use to do that, yeah. Again, those are written to work with particular kind of direct debit processes and so on. So it's a matter of really looking and seeing, okay, both maybe what you're using currently in terms of your organization, but also looking and seeing what's available for Civi and, you know. But so can it do direct debits? Yes, but it needs a bit of looking at in terms of the detail of exactly, you know, what which way you want to go with it. So if we set up with a payment processor, we could take do a credit card donation there on the phone, or payment for membership or whatever. Activities. So the activity log really is from exactly that. It's recording the different kind of interactions that this person has had with your organisation. And some of those get added automatically. So here you'll see it's just recorded both our payment for student membership and the membership itself. So we didn't do anything as such to specifically record those activities. That's just happened automatically from the system. Other things are, if there are things that Civi doesn't know about, you record yourself. So if we've had a phone call, for example, that we want to record, then we get up this activity screen. We've said it's a phone call, and we can then you can put in some more details and so on. If, as in this case, the phone call has already happened, we probably want to change this status to be completed because it's done. If, on the other hand, we were setting up something, you know, to call somebody next week, then we'd leave that as scheduled. Then that shows in the upcoming activities lists and so on. But for this, we'll close that. Then you see various different options down here on the activity. So this is sort of standard basic activity, which has a type, some sort of subject, a date and time, and a status. Beyond that, you can record a bunch of other things. So you can add some attachments, if you wish. If you're setting up something that's a regular activity, there's now this repetition piece, which is quite nice. That's a relatively new thing, where you can set it up to recur, you know, whatever, every Monday. So in that sense, there can be a, it can do some of the sorts of functions, for example, that you might put in your calendar to remind you, you know, whatever it is. Prepare the meeting agenda on the, you know, whatever, Monday afternoon.
So
sorry.
If I put something in there for repeat activity, it just means it'll create a new record, or it will go off and do something like email that person or print something out.
So this.
Just create a new record to say this activity has happened again?
It depends on what the activity type is that we're looking at. So this one is just recording that we've had a phone call. And yeah, I think it's probably true for most of these particular ones. This is more a reminder to go do.
So if I set up a repeat for a phone call, it wouldn't just create a record. The repeat function wouldn't be to create a record saying the phone call made on Monday. The repeat function would be to send me a reminder to make a phone call on Monday.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Because otherwise, they're speaking, is it going to go off and record something's happened and maybe it didn't actually happen?
True. No. No. But it's also going to, when it does that, it's going to set it as a scheduled status.
Okay.
So it's not yet happened, you've put in the system to happen. From there, you're either going to change it to completed, so you did do it, or cancel it if okay. It wasn't relevant or whatever. Yeah.
Where does it remind you, on your dashboard or?
Yes. Yeah. Shows you on a dashboard. And one thing that's quite useful is you can schedule follow-ups. So if having had our phone call this week, we now want to arrange a meeting for next week, you could do it here. Note, you can also assign it to somebody else. So you may have had the phone call, but you're now passing it on to somebody else to do the meeting, that sort of thing. Sorry. Sorry. No, that wasn't. Good try. Okay, so they've just told me we've got about 5 minutes left. So. Anyway, that's an activity. Cases, relationships, we'll look at those briefly. So relationships are both, as it were, things you might expect, like spouse, parent-child, that sort of thing. When you create a relationship between two individuals, it kind of, as it were, occurs on both ends. So if we look at Betty will see it. If we look at Bob's record, we'll see kind of he also has see with the other end of that relationship. They can be between people, they can be between people and organisations, so maybe employer, employee is a standard one. And they can either be current relationships, or in this case, they're inactive. So they were, but they're no longer. Groups. Okay, we can define groups in a bunch of different ways. useful for all sorts of things. They're kind of the heart of the mailing side of things. So if you want to send, for example, your newsletter, that would be a group. Newsletter subscribers there. In a regular group, you put somebody in, you take somebody out, they stay there until you take them out again. nobody gets added automatically, it's static. Smart groups are a bit different in that we can, if we want to find or look at the people, for example, who have, donated in the last 3 months, that's kind of a rolling thing, it's going to keep changing. We could set up a smart group of donors in the last 3 months. And then each time you come to use that, it's going to have the current people in, not those who've aged out of it. Notes, tags, codes. Yes. Okay. I think we'll stop there in terms of additional stuff. So very briefly, any questions before they kick us out of here and move on?
Those of us that are coming to this not having Civi already probably have databases of our own at the moment. Mm-hmm. How easy is it to prepare and import data into Civi from wherever we may have it already?
Okay, so that depends. So it depends how clean your data is.
Yeah, I expect some cleaning up of the data to have to happen.
Yeah. Often, if it's in another database, then there's some hope that it's reasonably structured. If, on the other hand, it's more in a spreadsheet, there's often more variability in terms of formatting and all that sort of stuff. So it takes some cleanup of that. We can import contacts. It depends in terms of the size, the number of contacts you're talking about. It has an import screen here. For example, we can import contacts. And it takes us through a sort of step-by-step process from a CSV. We define what we're importing and so on. And then we move on to the next thing. And that essentially says, so what are we doing with this field? This field is the first name. This other field is the last name, and so on. That works well with...
That's the screen I wanted to see.
Okay.
Yes.
That works relatively well with smallish sets of data. Alternatively, there are other ways of getting data into Civi that are more complex, admittedly, but can be more flexible too.
What
you can script
small,
stuff.
In your work, the definition of smallish?
I mean...
hundreds, 50...
probably in a single one without it on a relatively modest kind of system, you can probably do 500 to 1,000 kind of import in one go without it particularly choking.
3,000.
Okay. Yeah.
Can't
Bit depends in terms of the also the number of different fields you're importing and complexity and so on. Would say that sometimes if it's in an existing database, if you have lots of kind of key type relationships going on there, then yeah, you need to look a bit more carefully at that.
Churn me out a here's a blank template of what your contact card might look like in a CSV that you can then fill the data in for.
One option you can for that is just to do an export. Yeah. If you do a find, one of the options then is to export. Do an export, and you'll get that, and that'll get you about 95%.
Excellent.
There's some bits that. The export is a little different to the import.
The system you've shown is obviously very much a back end.
Yes.
It's very similar to many other charity CRMs that I've seen. Slight naming differences, but it's been copied well. and improved upon, no doubt. So the bit that really interests me is what could a front end look like? How does this tie into, which is where the others fail,
yep,
a web environment? You sort of alluded to it with the payment processing.
Yep.
But, I mean, this, to be honest, is absolutely no different to what I've got.
Right.
In terms of a back end,
yep,
I can do all of this stuff.
Okay.
How is it? The thing that sets Civi apart to me is and therefore should integrate nicely into my Drupal environment.
Indeed, yes. Okay, so Civi sits on top of either Drupal or WordPress or Joomla, and quite what it looks like is very much determined by the way you've got your Drupal theming, for example. And so it provides kind of the core pages. If you booked on the through the CiviCon London site, so, oops, dependent on the internet connection here.
It's good, this cloud stuff, isn't it?
Okay, if this were working. Instead of a blank screen, oh, there we go, we got there. So that is sort of out of Civi. And then the book your place is a Civi registration screen, and they are throwing me out. But there, for example, is what it could look like through there. But it's very much down to how you do your kind of Drupal theming type stuff. But and as you saw there, it's very different things. You can select what you want. You can pay. You can
code it back into those fields you've just been interested within.
Yes. Within, yeah. Yeah. So here. We do this, that comes straight back into Civi. Okay, we better stop there. If you want to ask any questions, I'm around. Do come talk.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.